AHSHAWAR, shalom, shalom. First and foremost, I would like to give all praises to the Most High Yahweh, Bahasham Yahweh Shai, Waharuka Kodash. Yahweh is the true name of the Most High God, the one whom the world ignorantly calls Yahweh and all other names. Yahweh Shai is the true name of His only begotten Son, the one whom the world ignorantly calls Jehovah, Jesus, Yeshua, etc. Ruka Kodash is the Holy Spirit that gives us understanding of this truth, which comes directly from the Most High Yahweh, Bahasham, and the name of His only begotten Son, Yahweh Shai. My double honors to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone, GMS, who taught me this truth, which is the 100% truth. Peace and salutations to the hopeful elect spread around the four corners of the earth, pushing this gospel in all sincerity. Shalom to the few Aquat sisters who are sincerely seeking this truth. It's the brother Yaraya YASHARAHLA from the GMS Italy camp. And I just wanted to come up with this lesson entitled, The Name Jesus is Associated with a Bloodthirsty Deity. And hopefully, Yahweh HaShemiah Shairataza, which means willing, Most High Yahweh in the name of His only Son, begotten Son, Yahweh Shai, willing, this lesson is going to be edifying. And each proof I'm going to bring out is going to be historical proofs. They're not going to be stuff that I made up myself, you know. I'm just going to go into the Wikipedia and I'll bring out this fact. So first of all, I'll put this image on the screen so you can see. This image that you see right here, we know that it's the image of Caesar Borgia, Cesare Borgia, who is the son, I believe the second son of the sixth pope, okay, who was a tyrant, a killer. He was a devil, man. He was more than a devil. You should go check his history for yourself, you know. And that's the image that's been kept as the savior. The name of the savior has been changed by the so-called devils, the white man, the so-called white men who are in power today, the powers that be, which has been ordained by the Most High Yahweh HaShem Yahweh Shai. The powers that be right now are being ordained by the Most High Yahweh HaShem Yahweh Shai, you know. And the end of the rule of this wickedness is just right at its end, you know, at its brink. So you don't want to be caught up, you know, calling on a false name and be disencouraged at the end. And what's the right word I'm looking for? And be disgraced, you know, being short of words, you know. You don't want to be caught up, you know, calling a fake deity. Then at the end of the day, you find out that that was not his name, and you get to get punished, you know, because the Son of the Most High, Yahweh Shai, is coming to save and to kill, to save and to destroy. He already came to die for our sins. Now he's coming back to save those who have, you know, with all their hearts sought for his truth, sought for him, and walked in his words. And he's coming also to destroy those who despise the truth. Now let's get into the lesson quickly. So as I did some lessons ago, you know, I spoke about the webarchive.org, which is the Wayback Machine, which takes you back to articles that have been edited on the website. So you can just go watch, you know, the lesson I did, I think 2-3 lessons ago, which is entitled The Language of Canaan, to know how this works. So now, this is the name Jesus, okay? This is Wikipedia. It says, Jesus or Jesus means Lord or Master, okay? It says, was a Gaulish god known from two monumental statues and a line in Lucan's Bellum Civile. It says the two statues on which this name appears are the pillars of the pillar of the boatman from among the Parisi and a pillar from Trea among the Trevi. In both of these, Jesus is portrayed cutting branches from trees with his axe. And that's the image you see right there. That's the image of this deity, Jesus. You know, looks like a so-called Edomite, you know. I don't know, could be it's a deity anyway, you see, chopping down trees, which that also goes into, you know, this Christmas tree, whatever that they do, in which is an abomination. You're going to find the writing in the book of Jeremiah chapter 10, you know. So he says, Jesus is accompanied on different panels of the pillar of the boatman by Tavo Trigaranos, the bull with three cranes, Jupiter, Vulcan, and other gods. It says the name Jesus is cognate of Zeus, who as the tree splitter is associated with both axes and tree. So hey, check out, it says the name Jesus is cognate to Zeus, and cognate means associated. Now let's look up that word cognate. It says cognate means related, associated. So in other words, you can say the name Jesus is related of Zeus, and you know who Zeus is. Zeus is a Greek deity. Okay, it say who as the tree splitter is associated with both axes and trees. So now it says a well-known section in Lucan's Bellum Civile talks about the gory sacrificial offerings proffered to a triad of Celtic deities. Now, gory means, let's look it up. It says grisly, bloody, okay, involving or showing violence and bloodshed. So it says, this is a, so it says, it's a triad, where is it? It says, Bellum Civile talks about the gory sacrificial offerings preferred to a triad of Celtic deities. That goes back to the Trinity, okay? The Trinity that the Christian churches are pushing very hard on you. Okay, it says, this is the name of the Trinity. It says, Theotates, Jesus, and Taranis. Among a pair of later commentators on Lucan's work, one identifies Theotates with Mercury and Jesus with Mars. And these were the gods that, you know, these Greeks, these Greco-Romans and the Romans, you know, these were the gods they were worshipping, you know. And it says, according to the Bend commentary on Lucan, human victims were sacrificed to Jesus by being tied to a tree and flayed. And this word flayed goes back into flogged to death, which we're going back to. This is the, this this was the article, brother, I believe in 2014, I believe, or 2004. I went back, you know. Then I'm going to go back to the article that's updated today. So it says, human sacrifice, they sacrifice humans to this deity, Jesus, okay, by tying them on the tree and flogging them to death. It says, these commentaries come from the 9th century AD, okay. It says, though, and their source is in doubt, you know, in which, you know, when they tell you about this thing, they will always tell you, they will always put it that it's in doubt, but that's the fact right there. Now, let's come here, pay attention. It says, the 18th century Druidic revivalist Lolo Morganwig, pardon me if I don't pronounce that well, says, identifies Jesus with Jesus. It says, the 18th century Druidic revivalist Lolo Morganwig identified Jesus with Jesus. on the strength of the similarity of their names. He also linked them both with who got done writing. Okay, he says, both who and won were no doubt originally identical with the house of Lactantius, okay, and Jesus of Lacan, described as gods of the Gauls. The similarity of the last name to Jesus, Welsh Jesus, is obvious and striking. This identification is still made in certain Neo-Druidic circles. Now, the question is, what has the name of Jesus to do with other names of, you know, bloodthirsty deities? That's a question you should ask yourself. You know, what has light to do with darkness? You know, this, the name of our Savior is a special name, you know. It's a name that no one is called that name on earth, you know. And that's how special that name is. It's a special name. He was Hebrew Israelite. And how come he is given the name of a Greek? Because Jesus is a Greek. Now, let's go into the name Jesus. Well, anyway, first of all, before going into the name Jesus, let's get the updated Wikipedia, you know. You can say that's the name Jesus. Now, over here, it's still the same thing, you know. They tell you, okay, listen, it says over here, according to Ben's commentary on Lucan, human victims were sacrificed to Jesus by being tied to a tree and flogged to death. And that's not all. Children were also sacrificed to Jesus, in which, in order to see that, we can go back, because I was making a series of researches that brought me to this Jesus, that brought me also to this human sacrifice, in which it says, victims meant for Jesus were hanged or tied to a tree and flogged to death. Okay, the loon man being an example, those meant for, so it's actually talking of the triad, the, what do you call it, the trinity of these deities that we just spoke about. Now, Jesus, going back to Jesus, I'll just pick a few things from here, in which you can go and read it by yourself. It also says, but there is no evidence that it was a Celtic Jehovah or member with the Teutates and Taranis. So what has it to do with the Jehovah? And you see, when they start telling you stuff like this, they're just trying to hide the truth. He is linked to that Jehovah. Now let's go. It says Jesus. It says John de Vries finds ground of comparison between Jesus and Odin. And if you go down to Odin, Odin is a deity. Okay, he's a blood-tested deity in which children are sacrificed to him, a one-eyed deity. Okay. Now check this out. It says Miranda Green suggests that the willow tree that Jesus heals may symbolize the tree of life, with its association of destruction and death in winter and rebirth in the spring. And that tree of life goes into Kabbalah, you know, these Khazars that are occupying the land of Israel today. They are so deep into that worship, which is a demonic worship that goes back to Baal. Okay, now it says in the 18th century, this is what we just read, it says Lactinos and the Jesus of Lactan, described as God of the Gauls, the similarity of the last name Jesus. You see, so Jesus, the name Jesus is associated with this name Jesus. Now let's go to the name Jesus, and as I showed you, this is the time machine. You see, the way back machine, it takes you back. So I actually went back to 2004 the first time that, you know, they put, I believe the second time they edited this Jesus article. Let me take that off. So you can see. So we're going to skip down to... let me read something here. It says, according to those religions conventionally designated as Christian, Jesus is the Messiah and the Son of God who brought salvation to humanity through his death and resurrection. It says, Jesus is also regarded as an ascetic prophet by Muslims, okay, as a false Messiah by Judaism and Mandanism, as a manifestation of God by the Baha'i, a manifestation of Maitreya by some Buddhists, as an avatar by some Hindus, as the savior and bringer of Gnosis by various Gnostic sects, and as a guru by many new ageists. So now, what they're trying to say, in other words, is there are all these different religions that have their ideas on who Jesus truly is, you know? And you can see most of these religions, they can associate the name Jesus to their deity, their principal deity. Now, if you do a deep research on all these religions, you know, it's going to take you all back to the ancient Babylon. And not only the ancient Babylon, it takes you back to Egypt, in which Egypt takes you back to the ancient Sumerians, you know, during the time of Nimrod, you know, when he tried to unite the whole world and make them worship one God, you know, all these deities goes back to that time, you know. That's another lesson for another time. And what I see here is nothing but the Council of Nicaea. Now, you can go look that up. That could be another lesson for another day. The Council of Nicaea, in which, in order to just summarize it, they took all these different religions, all these different pagan worships, you know, they put all together and rebranded it and called it Christianity, you know. That's what the Council of Nicaea is actually all about, you know. They rebranded everything, you know, include this Trinity worship that I just showed you, and included everything in just one religion and called it, you know, Christianity. And that's what you can see right here. Now, the question is, what has light to do with darkness, you know? And it's written in the book of Isaiah 42 verse 8. Let's quickly get it. It says his glory would never share with any other deity. This is the book of Isaiah 42, I believe, in verse 8. It says, I am the Lord Yahweh, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. So what's the point? You know, the name of Yahweh Shai is a special name. Now let's go down. I just brought that, you know. I'm going to skip here because I don't want to keep this lesson too long. Now, let's go. It says the name of Jesus Christ. It says Jesus is derived from Latin, Jesus, which in turn comes from the Greek, Jesus. So you can say the name Jesus comes from the Greek, Jesus. But we know our Lord and Savior is a Hebrew Israelite of the tribe of Judah. So he has a Hebrew name. His name is not Jesus. And we're still going to bring more proofs. It says, the Greek form is a transliteration of the Aramaic name, Yeshua, a short form of Hebrew, Yehoshua. It says, Yeshua is a short form of Yehoshua, which means the Lord is salvation, literally. Yahweh, Jehovah saves, you know? So now, if you go to this word, this is the modern Hebrew. You see, it says, Yahweh Shai. You know, that is what it is, in which we're going to go into that very soon. I'm going to show you that in the ancient, you have two types of Hebrew. You have this modern Hebrew that is a mixture of Yiddish Slavonic languages and ancient Babylonian or whatever, they just put up a mix, you know, and they present it to you as what do they call it, modern Hebrew. So what's wrong with the ancient Hebrew? Why do they dump that? Because that's going to expose who they are. That's going to expose the devils. So this is a modern Hebrew in which I'm going to show you what the ancient Hebrew looks like, and this is how the name of Yahawashai was written. And they added so many vowels into this new Hebrew that has nothing to do with the ancient Hebrew. So in the ancient Hebrew, you don't have the vowel e, and you don't have u, you know. But I'm going to show you very soon. Anyway, there is something I want to point out. It says the Greek form is a transliteration of the Aramaic name. So what is a transliteration? Because it is not a translation. A translation is different. Now let's go check out what's the meaning of transliteration. It says transliteration. This is the Cambridge Dictionary. It says the art or process of writing words using a different alphabet. So what they do is they look at this name and they figure out, you know, the alphabet that looks closer to that alphabet, and they call it that name, which could mean any other thing. It says their text aimed to produce a phonetic transliteration of dialects using the main languages of the day. Transliteration helps people speak a language by showing the pronunciation in the language they understand. Now check this out. It says the transliteration is inconsistent throughout and simply inaccurate in many instances. Transliteration is inaccurate, is inconsistent. Now, if you go into the word inconsistent, you look it up, it tells you erratic, error, incompatible. So you can see there is no way his name can be Jesus. And there is no way his name can be Jesus. That comes from the Greek. This is a transliteration. You see this word written in Greek right here, Jesus. It has nothing to do with this, you know. Now, having brought that, let me see if there is something else. Like, no, I'm good with this. Now let's go back to, what do I want to go back to? Now, as you can see, people call him different names, Jesus, Yeshua, whatever. You know, in which right here, let's bring this out. This is the ancient Hebrew, the Lashon Kodesh. You can see, it says, this is the book of Zephaniah, chapter 3, verse 9. It says, for then will I turn to the people of pure language, that they may all call upon the name of Yahweh to serve him with one consent. So it means if we don't have the true name today, it means that if we don't have this language, this Lashon Kodesh, it means that this prophecy is a lie. And, oh, God forbid, you know, men are liars, but the Most High is never a liar. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever, you know. So it's telling you that there is no U, O, A, or J, or V in the ancient Hebrew, which is the Lashon Kodesh, meaning the Holy Tongue. So this is the Lashon Kodesh you read from the right to the left, in which makes so much sense, in which in this backward society we live today, they make us write from the left to the right, all backwards. So you have A, Ba, Ga, Da, Ha, Wa, Za, Cha, Ta, Ya, Ka, La, Ma, Na, Sa, A, Pa, Taza, Ka, Ra, Sha, Ta. You see? Now, this is the name of the Savior written in ancient Hebrew, and this is the name of the Father written in ancient Hebrew. This is Yahweh. Now, this letter, it goes to here. You see, Yah. This second letter is this, is Ha. Okay? This letter that looks like a Y is Wa. And this letter again, Ha. So, it gives you Yah. Ha, Wa. And this is the name of the Son. You see, it comes in the name of his Father. You know, you can see that all these are all similar. Then this is salvation. Now just watch, it says Yah, and Yahweh means he exists, you know, he is, you know. This is Yahweh Shai, means the Savior, he who saves. So you see the name goes back, where is it? I'm lost. YASHAHLA. So you can say the true name of the Son of the Most High is YAHWASHAI, okay, which is his original Hebrew name. So what they did is they picked these letters and they transliterated them to something totally else. Then fortunately, it was all translated to presume that deity, which is Zeus, you see, which is also known as Jesus. so you see why these Christians and all these other Hebrew Israelite camps that are not calling on the true name of the Most High Yahweh Shemiahoshai, you know, you see where they are, you know, they have a zeal according to knowledge, they have a zeal but not according to knowledge. Let's get that zeal. Now, this is the book of Romans, chapter 10, verse 2. It says, "For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge." These people, they have a zeal, but not according to knowledge. These deities that they're calling on are not the true name of the Most High. They're calling on devils, you know. They're God calling on bloodthirsty devils, you know. Now, let's go into the scriptures. I'm going to start from the book of 1 Corinthians. First Corinthians 12:2. This is the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse. I'll read from verse 1. It says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant." It says, "Ye know that ye were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led." We were all Gentiles and we were carried away into these dumb idols. Okay? You know, during the time of the Roman conquest, that's in 70 AD, starting from 66 AD, you know, the Romans came into Jerusalem. They destroyed Jerusalem. And even before that, the northern kingdom were all carried away, slaves into the land of Babylon, you know? And many of them fled. Okay, according to the second book of Ezra, they went to the continent of America, you know, and they were the first people there before Cristobal Colon went there. But they weren't actually the real first people who were there. The first people on the land of America were the Hamites, you know, during the time of King Solomon. They used to go there, used to be known as Ophir, the land of Ophir. They used to go there to get gold and all these precious metals and stuffs, you know. So anyway, that's just by the way, you know, the elder apostle Taha always brings out lessons on that. So we were all carried away Gentiles into, we became Gentiles because, you know, we lost our heritage. We lost our heritage and we were, no, I believe there is that scripture that speaks about heritage. You know, we losing our heritage. It says, "You shall cease from thy heritage." So you can see, it says in the book of Jeremiah 12:7, it says, "I have forsaken my house." This is the Most High. He has forsaken us. "I have left mine heritage. I have given the dearly beloved of my soul into the land of our enemies." We're given into the hands of our enemies. But this is not the one I'm looking for. This is the one I'm looking for. The book of Jeremiah 17:4. It says, "And thou, even thyself, shalt discontinue from thine heritage." that I give thee, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not. For ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, which shall burn forever. Our heritage is the laws and the statutes, you know. We were a peculiar people, we were chosen, we were set aside people, you know. And, you know, we made the Most High angry by doing these things, by going to worship deities like Jesus, going to worship all these pagan deities, demonic, bloodthirsty deities, in which we have our own power, you know. So the Most High carried us away slaves, we lost our heritage. And you can see, now it says, you know that you were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as you were led, you know. So we are actually led into all these dumb idols, you know. But there comes a time in which you need to wake up to the truth and return. So those who are not going to find this truth and return, they're going to be destroyed, you know. And it's told in the book of 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 16. It says, study to show thyself approved, you know, dividing the word of truth. You know, just roughly paraphrasing. So these Christians, these church pastors are not going to do this. And those wicked Hebrew Israelite groups also that are teaching Jesus, you know, they're all going to be destroyed because they're not seeking this truth, you know, with all their sincerity. Now, this is the book of John 4:22. This is the book of John 4:22. It says, ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. Okay, these people, they worship what they don't even know. They worship strange gods, strange deities. But those who come into this truth, they know what they worship. And salvation is only for the house of Israel. Okay? Salvation is for the house of Israel. Only for the, exclusively for the house of Israel. So if you're not of the house of Israel, you're not going to be saved. And we are praying, you know. We are going to be counted amongst those numbers of those people that are going to be saved. And through the Spirit, we know we are of the house of Israel. Once you can understand this truth, once the whole Holy Spirit, the Ruach Kodesh, works with you and guides you to accepting this truth, then you are definitely of the house of Israel, because the wicked cannot accept this truth, you know. So these people, they worship what they don't know. They believe they're worshiping the Most High, you know. They are blind. Now let's go into the book of always John, chapter 9, verse 31. It says, now we know that the Most High, Yahweh Shemiah Shai, heareth not sinners. But if any man be a worshipper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth. The Most High does not hear sinners. And we know sin is sin is the transgression of the law. We are given laws. So when you transgress these laws, you sin. And we are told in that law not to worship any other god. Worship no other god, man. The Most High Yahweh Shemiah Shai is specifically let us know he is a jealous power, man. Worship no other god. But then we go after all these other gods of all these other nations around us. Now these devils brought this deity to you, and that's the deity, the link with this name Jesus, in which if you only take time and you pray for the spirit of understanding, just like the book of James 1:15, 1:5 or so, it says, he who lacketh understanding, let him ask. The scripture also says, knock and it shall be opened, seek and ye shall find. If you lack knowledge, you pray humbly and you ask for this knowledge, and it shall be given unto you. But these people, they are good in what they know. They don't take time to go look for other things. They just want to be in their comfort zones, you know. And they are all going to be punished, man. All what they do these are vain sacrifices. They believe when they do all these good things, when they sing and scream in the churches, they believe they are offering good sacrifices unto the Most High, but they are actually offering to devils. This is the book of 1 Corinthians. Ten twenty. This is the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 20. It says, "But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to Yahweh power. And I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils." So that's what I'm saying. What has light to do with with darkness? You don't offer the same sacrifice that these devils offer unto their deities. Now, very soon, Christmas is right at the corner, you know? You see Jake's all bugged out, these Christians, you know, pulling up the Christmas tree, you know, going crazy and doing all sort of madness, you know? Doing Thanksgiving, they don't even know the meaning of Thanksgiving. Going into, Halloween, they don't know what it means. You know, celebrating Easter, which they don't know what's the meaning of Easter. It says, "But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. And I would not that ye should fellowship with devils." These Christians, they are all fellowshipping with devils. Even the Hebrew Israelite groups that are not calling the name of the Most High Yahweh and His Son Yahweh Shai, they are all sacrificing to devils. There is only one name that has been given under heaven, man, that man should call upon. And that name is Yahweh Bahasham Yahweh Shai. Bahasham means in the name. Now, to close this lesson, I'm going to read from the book of Acts 4. Acts 4, is it 12? This is the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 12. It says, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." There is no salvation in any other name. You can call Jesus, you can call Jesus, you can call Jehovah, you can call Yeshua. These are all transliterations. These have no strong validity of the truth, man. There is no other name. There is only just one name given under heaven. And that name is Yahweh Shai. Salvation comes only through that name. Now, if you go into Jesus in other languages, if you go into this, Jesus in other languages, you're going to see all different nonsense that goes back to Jesus. All I see here is Jesus, you know, Jesus. See, you know, this is all craziness, man. You see, this is Jesus, you know, Jesus, in which we just read actually that they all go back to this name, to this deity, you know. Where is it again? It says Jesus is identified with Jesus, man. You know? It says, "Hes, Eos of Lactantius, and the Jesus of Lucan describe the gods of the gods, the similarity of the last name, Jesus, Welsh, Jesus." You know? So these people are actually calling on Zeus when they call that name Jesus. They're calling on Zeus, you know, transfigured in a different name called Jesus, you know. And hey, you better wake up, man, because there is really no time, you know, going through all these things. If the spirit works with you, you understand, and you come out of all these, you know, wicked philosophies that are going to lead you to death. You know, this is the image. This is what's going to do. That's the devil right there, you know, pushing all these fake names and transliterations. People don't go and seek out things by themselves. They don't care. They just want to be okay. And, you know, and they regurgitate whatever is given to them, man. You know, and this is a stone, a Moabite stone. Well, it's found. This is a writing from the king of the Moabites, the modern day Chinese, that, you know, you can find the name of the Most High right there, you know, in Paleo Hebrew. These are historical facts. So if you go back to the ancient Hebrew, you find out that there is no all these vowels. There is no U, there is no O, there is no E, there is no J or V in the ancient Hebrew, which his name is Hebrew. Having said this, I hope this lesson was edifying. I'd like to give all praises to the Most High Yahweh, Bahasham, Yahawashai, Waharuka Kodash. My double honors to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone GMS who taught me this truth, which is the 100% truth. Peace and salutations to the hopeful elect spread around the four corners of the earth. Shalom.